The dialogue.
Hello and welcome, ladies and gentlemen, to the latest episode of Tech for Good series. And today I'm really, really happy to have a very special guest with me. I have Rihanna Pfefferkorn. She is the Associate Director at Stanford Center for Internet Society, Stanford University, and she is a leading authority on encryption policy in the world. And we are really grateful to Rihanna to be talking to us today. Rihanna, thank you so much for coming in and joining us from the US.
Thank you for having me, Kazem.
Pleasure. And apologies for my shoddy hairstyle. This is the result of the lockdown. But nevertheless, Rihanna, thank you so much for talking in today. And, you know, we've been following your work over the last few months. We've been talking about collaborating with Stanford. And I think it's great that we're able to talk to you today and learn about the encryption policy issues in the US and how those link up in India, because there's a lot of debate happening in the country, especially around the intermediary liability. The Home Ministry released a draft set of guidelines in December 2018, to which we responded. And I think you also have written as part of a coalition. And we are still waiting for the final set of guidelines while there's an ongoing case going on in the Supreme Court. And nevertheless, there are a lot of debate now with the lockdown coming in and the use of internet and the use of video messaging tools. And encryption is back in the debate in terms of how important it is to have end-to-end security. And those are some of the issues I would like to discuss with you. So I would like to start with you, Rihanna, in terms of understanding the level of encryption which we need in the globe today. And you've been following the debate in India and in the US. So my first question to you is, how do you feel about the evolution of the encryption debate so far? And where do you think it's going at this current stage?
So in my experience, after working on this issue for 4 or 5 years now, in the United States, we've been having kind of the same argument for 20 or 25 years, ever since the 1990s, really, about whether and sort of how much security and encryption technology the general public should be allowed to have. It has never been controversial that encryption is necessary to protect financial data, to protect national security information, military information, you know, government affairs. But because of the availability of encryption technology in very popular products and apps and devices such as WhatsApp now, it's become more of an issue, because once encryption becomes more available to everybody, it becomes more available for both bad actors as well as good actors. So in the United States, this has been sort of going round and round in circles with this debate. And it seems to me that we've reached a very similar point right now here in the US as in India, where in both countries we have these limitations on the liability that intermediary platforms are exposed to for the actions of their users on the platform. And now in both countries, we see proposals that would threaten that immunity from liability if the platforms do not do something or other that would basically assist law enforcement. And I think that so far in India, this proposal has been more advanced, being out for a year and a half now, than we have in the United States, where it's only really been in the last few months that we've seen this proposal to change immunity in order to hold intermediary platforms more accountable for the actions of their users, mm-hmm. and try to incentivize them to make more concessions to help law enforcement investigate on their services. But with that said, the advent of encryption by default in the apps that we use for chat and for the devices that we use has been a huge boon for personal safety, for public security, for data security, really for everybody. Because in addition to protecting the security of, say, your other biometric data or banking information, financial information, it also protects your personal communications. And, you know, one thing that I think the United States has to be envious of India is that in India, your Supreme Court has declared that there is a fundamental human right to privacy. And here, we have not yet really gotten that far. We have, the right to privacy with respect to the government in our Constitution and our Bill of Rights. But it has not been recognized as something fundamental that must be respected at quite that level. In the more consumer area, it's really still kind of a transactional notion of privacy that we have in the United States is something that you can bargain away in exchange for usually some sort of free online service or what have you. So I think that that is a strong base on which to build the encryption debate in India, now that you have, in the Puttaswamy decision, the Declaration of the Fundamental Human Right of Privacy. And that's something that I hope that we can try and build upon here in the United States as we try and move forward with building up rather than tearing down protections for strong encryption here.
It's great that you speak about the right to privacy judgment, Diana. And we've been seeing that, you know, possibly that in the intermediate guidelines draft, there are certain indications that those rights could be curtailed. One of the key challenges which India is facing right now is, and the security establishment has been asking for flexibility to be able to deal with crimes in a better manner, and to be able to reach out, to be able to investigate in a much more holistic manner. So policymakers and the government believe that it's important to have traceability. Now, I want to understand from you, how important is it with respect to traceability? That do you really need traceability in the case to solve law investigation in sort of cases to solve crimes? Or is metadata enough to be able to do that? Because there is enough research to suggest that traceability may not be the answer with respect to solving crimes. What's your opinion on that?
So my opinion is that right now, law enforcement in every country really have access to more types of data that exist than there ever were before, because of the huge amount of electronic data that we are now producing all the time, constantly through our communications, through the activities that we do online, through our movements in the physical world, due to location data tracking for our devices. The amount of metadata that is out there and the number of sources of data has really multiplied even just within the last 10, 15 years, beyond anything that had really been seen before. And so while I understand that law enforcement finds that metadata is not a replacement, a 100% replacement for access to the contents of a communication, in many instances, metadata is still able to provide a wealth of information about who a particular individual talked to, what their web of contacts are, where they went, and their financial history. And in addition, you know, a lot of the times, or depending on apps or depending on the settings of your phone, the backups of the contents of your messages can be available as well. And then it's more a discussion of what are the legal barriers to easily being able to obtain that information if it is not held domestically in India, but rather, say, on a server in the United States. And then I think that gets into a different realm where it's saying, what are the cross-border data flow barriers, rather than is this a cause for undermining encryption? From what I have seen, even including in some recent terror attacks here in the United States, eventually our law enforcement services are able to get into bypass encryption on a device in order to get access to the phone and the phone's data that is on it. So from what I can see, law enforcement has not been precluded from doing their jobs or doing their jobs effectively.
Right.
And on top of all of that, all we really have to go on is really sort of stories and anecdotes from law enforcement. I don't know about in India, but here we don't have any good statistics about exactly what the marginal impact of encryption is on law enforcement investigations. Our Federal Bureau of Investigation used to compile release numbers on how many devices, locked devices, they had in custody that they weren't able to get into. They later realized that there had been some methodology problems with how they were counting that and admitted that those numbers were much lower than the numbers that they had been telling the public. They've never corrected those numbers, and it's been a couple of years now. And so unless we can contextualize, you know, what is the ultimate actual impact, where encryption is the but-for cause, you know, the proximate cause of some criminal not being brought to justice or some attack happening that would not otherwise have happened, it's really difficult to have the informed public debate that needs to occur among the general public and among policymakers and legislators in both countries or any other country about whether encryption has turned out to be too much of an obstacle for law enforcement or not. And I think that that murkiness, that lack of hard data, is something that redounds to the benefit of law enforcement, but it doesn't really help advance the policy debate at all.
It's interesting you spoke about that, the fact that law enforcement may not be precluded from solving crimes. And I just want to say hi to your cat. I think behind you, I think on the window, she's been moving around. So just want to say a hello to the cat over there. Really cool. I love the way, you know, there's a setup for the cat. But all right, moving on. I want to sort of now get to this understanding of it. You believe that at this stage that there might not be a requirement to break into traceability, and that's something which, you know, a lot of civil society organizations in India have been talking about and fighting for. And also, Rihanna, do you think that if, let's say, we break encryption and if the government gets the key, would that open a Pandora's box for non-state actors, terrorists, criminals to then basically hack into the chat rooms and just sort of keep breaking into various sort of applications? Because once you open this up, and they have access to technology, we've seen that with ISIS and others, they've had access to technology and research. So don't you open sort of a bigger threat? So the cost-benefit analysis of finding something very small leading to a bigger problem, where do you think this could lead us?
Right, yes. I mean, I absolutely agree with you that it seems to me that weakening encryption for law enforcement would be creating more problems than it would solve. Like I said, it seems to me that law enforcement is in many cases able to resolve a case or prevent a crime despite encryption. And encryption also prevents so many crimes. And so if it is weakened, the very same bad actors who would love to be able to get access to your phone, to get, you know, all of your messages, to be able to get into your apps, get into your bank account, et cetera, would have that same way in. We've seen with law enforcement's ability to get devices from third parties that can take advantage of some flaw that will always exist in any software code for various versions of smartphones. The devices that third-party vendors sell to law enforcement can also end up on the secondary market, such as on eBay. Right. And then from there, it's possible for those to fall into the hands of organized crime who can, you know, much more efficiently. There's a lot more worth in a phone from the stuff that's in it than from the mere fact of having a lump of metal that you can, you know, steal and resell or what have you. And so, you know, from a security standpoint, that kind of data security risk from weakening encryption or creating a hole just for law enforcement, the risk is that inevitably is going to be found and exploited by bad actors as well. And it can't just be limited to the police. One analogy that I hear used when comparison when law enforcement say, you know, it should be possible to build an exceptional access capability into encryption just for law enforcement, is a comparison to the phone systems, where the law requires that the phone networks make their systems wiretappable so that law enforcement can listen in on phone calls. And they say, well, we've got that. Isn't that good enough? And the answer is not necessarily. We've seen instances, not in America or in India that I know of, but in other countries, where the wiretap capabilities in the nation's phone system were discovered and used by bad actors to spy on top government officials. This happened in Greece, where the mayor of Athens and a number of other officials and diplomats were secretly having their phone calls listened on and eavesdropped upon by unknown actors, possibly, you know, another government, for example. Using the same capability for enabling law enforcement to listen in on phone calls. And so these mechanisms for law enforcement can be turned against the government themselves, in addition to being potentially discovered and used against normal people.